أعوذ بالله من الشيطان اللعين الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله الذي لا يبلغ مدحته القائلون ولا يحصي نعماه العادون ولا يؤدي حقه المجتهدون الذي بعد فلا يرى وقرب فشهد النجوى تبارك وتعالى والصلاة والسلام على سيد الأنبياء وخاتم المرسلين وشفيع المذنبين سيدنا ونبينا بالقاسم محمد وعلى أهل بيته الطيبين الطاهرين المعصومين الذين أذهب الله عنهم الرجس وطهرهم تطهيرا واللائين الدائمة الباقية على أعدائهم ومنكر فضائلهم وغاصب حقوقهم من الآن إلى قيام يوم الدين أما بعد فقد قال الله سبحانه وتعالى في كتابه الكريم إن الله اصطفى آدم ونوحا وآل إبراهيم وآل عمران على العالمين ذرية بعضهم من بعض والله سميع عليم صلوات عليك برحمة الله سبحانه وتعالى In Surah Al-Imran, ayat number 33 and 34, talks about the process of selection. And the ayat very clearly says that Allah is the one who has chosen a family from among the mankind in order to appoint them as the leaders and the guides for the society. It's interesting the way Allah begins the ayat, إِنَّ اللَّهَ اصْطَفَى. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala verily has chosen. The word istafa means the word to choose. Verily Allah has chosen Adam. The first representative of Allah on this earth was Adam. So he begins with Adam. وَنُوحًا. And then he goes immediately to Nuh. Because with the flood of Nuh, the children of Adam had perished. Whatever continued after that were with Nuh and the people of Nuh. And then Allah immediately goes to Wa'ala Ibrahim. He chose Adam, he chose Nuh, and he chose the family of Ibrahim. The family of Ibrahim is a very vast family. Allah had blessed him with two sons, Ismail and Ishaq. From Ishaq you have Bani Israel. From Ismail you have the Prophet and his family. But in order to make clear that when Allah says, I have chosen Adam and Nuh and the family of Ibrahim, not everyone from the descendants of Ibrahim is among the chosen one. So Allah wanted to qualify the term Ala Ibrahim. And therefore he adds the word Ala Imran. Ala Imran is a family from the descendants of Ishaq. That was just an indication. And so if you look at the other side of the line of Ibrahim from Ismail, there also this ayah does not say that everyone from the descendants of Ismail have been chosen. There also, just as on one line you have Ala Imran limited there, in the other line, you have those who are known as Ali Muhammad, Salawatullah alayhim ajma'een. So, Inna Allah istafa Adam wa Nuhan wa Ala Ibrahim wa Ala Imran ala al-alameen. He has chosen them over the rest of the people. And then he goes on to say, Zurriyatun ba'buha min ba'd. All of these are related to one another. They are from one another. Wallahu sami'un alim, and Allah is all hearing and all knowing. So we see this process of selection that Allah has talked about in this ayat, and there are other indications also. Tonight we have gathered to commemorate the wafat of one of those who is included in Ala Ibrahim here. One of the chosen ones who is known as Sibt Akbar, the older grandson of the Prophet. He is one of the two chiefs of the youths of paradise. He is the one about whom the Prophet says that he is a leader and an imam, no matter whether he sits down and makes peace with the enemy or stands up and fights against the enemy. And that is our second imam, Imam Hassan al-Mushtaba, alayhi salatu wassalam. The word istafa means Allah chose. And therefore Prophet Muhammad is known as Mustafa, Muhammad the chosen one. The word ijtaba also means to choose. And Hassan is al-Mujtaba. So Imam Hassan is also one of those who are chosen ones, as his title indicates. The ayat, after that, ayat 34. ذُرِّيَّةٌ بَعْضُهَا مِنْ بَعْضٍ. These are all descendants of Ibrahim. They are from one another. This ayat is actually saying to us that they are from one another, not in family ties only, even in their faith, in their mission, and the purpose of life, all of them are united. Isa cannot be different from Musa. Muhammad cannot be different from Ibrahim. Ali cannot be different from Hassan. Hassan cannot be different from Hussein. And so when we look at this, you know, this is where I would like to actually come to the theme about our second Imam. Because when you study the early history of Islam or the early history of Muslims, you'll see that indeed the history has been unfair to our second Imam. Because the early history of the Muslims is actually a mixture of truth, you know, half-truths, omissions, and many, many fabrications. And so we have to be careful about it. Many of these people who wrote the historical accounts in the early days, either they were under pressure of the governments of the time, or they were propaganda tools of the government itself. Those who were under pressure were careful. They were afraid not to say anything which will offend the rulers of the time. Those who were the tools of propaganda, of course, they had their own agenda. They would never say something which is going to be against the plan of the government. And we don't have to really go very far to understand this phenomenon. Look at Fox and CNN now. You know, they also have an agenda. They do not always speak the truth. It's half truth. Many times things are omitted. Some things are, you know, just ignored completely. Or sometimes it is outright fabrication. In December, when elections were going on in Russia, CNN basically broadcast a news saying that thousands of people showed up in Moscow protesting against president for the election which had happened. It is only later on that some of the observers looked at the video, and when they looked at it carefully, all the names of the shops and the banks in the background were all in Greek, not in Russia. And then they went back to the news reels of the other events of this year, and they realized that this is a footage of the protest in Athens because of the economic crisis there. But that was being portrayed as a protest taking place in Moscow. So what you see now is actually what was happening during the early days also. Historians had their own biases. Many of them were in the pay of the government, and therefore, you know, they have written things, ignored things, added things, and fabricated many things in the history. Salawat. One of the victims of false propaganda of the early history is the personality of our blessed second Imam, the grandson of the Prophet. Not only in the matter of the truce that he signed with Muawiyah, but even when it comes to the events surrounding the murder of the third Khalifa, Uthman ibn Affan, there are some very interesting comments about historians regarding Imam Hassan. And in that, we can say that really among all the Imams, Imam Hassan is the most mazloom person in history. The way he has been portrayed by the early historians. Even the Shias, if you look at the events I recited 2 years ago on the same occasion, about the reaction of the people to his decision of signing the peace treaty with Muawiyah. There were some among his sincere and true followers who could not understand the wisdom of his decision. And the way they reacted to his decision was really not acceptable. So he was mazloom even in his own community. But then as far as the opponents are concerned, they basically started to portray him as somebody who was indulged in luxuries of this world. You know, he was happy with the pension he was going to get from Muawiyah and spend his life marrying one woman, divorcing another, then marrying another one and divorcing another until they have a number of 80 to 300 for the wives of the second Imam. And this is a topic by itself, you know, we talked about it a few years ago. But another thing that we see is that more damaging than his, you know, attack on his personal character is his loyalty to his own father. This Quran, this ayah that I recited earlier, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has chosen this family, zurriyatun ba'buha min ba'az, they are from one another. They are united, not in family ties, but even in their faith and purpose of life. But the historians would like to say that in the events surrounding the murder of Uthman, the third Khalifa, Imam Hassan, they are saying, was with Uthman, on the side of Uthmanis, and he was against his own father. Now, mashallah, our people are getting into this habit of reading, you know, resources are becoming more available in English language, which is a good thing. But that is why I'm bringing this issue up. Keep in mind when you read the early history, even those which are now available in English, whether it's Tabari or others, you will come across with these kinds of statements. That in the case of murder of Uthman, you know, they are saying Hassan was with the third Khalifa, on the side, on that group, and not with his father. And this is not only early historians, even some of the contemporary writers, even in the Western world. And I'll give you one example of a book which I consider to be a pretty good book on the history of the Khilafat. In Oxford University, of course now he is retired, there's a professor by the name of Professor Wilford Medloom, expert in Arabic literature. And he also specializes in Shia theology and history. His last work, I don't think he, according to his age and health, would be able to produce anything more. But his last book is probably the best. And the title of the book is The Succession to Muhammad, where he talks about the history of the Khilafat. Right from the events of the first Khilafat in Saqifa, and then the second Khilafat, then the third, and ends with the Khilafat of Amir al-Mu'mineen. Even Professor Medloom, you know, his book, I consider it to be a pretty good book, especially when you realize he's a non-Muslim. He's the first Western scholar of Islam who has challenged the myth of the Saqifa. Because normally we are told Saqifa was a unanimous decision of the Ummah, and this was true democracy. He is the first Western scholar who has gone into details. And he challenges that. He says, no, Saqifa was not, you know, uncontested, and not, you know, without any problem and controversies. Rather, he comes out with a theory, and that's very interesting. Probably 2 years ago in Ghadir, I had presented his hypothesis that if there was true democracy and election after the wafat of the Prophet, he looks at possible candidates of the time. And he comes with his own analysis and he says, if there was true democracy and election after the Prophet, he says the only person likely to win that election would have been none other than Amirul Mu'mineen Ali bin Abi Talib alayhi salatu wasalam. I wish this book had been produced by a Shia scholar. Unfortunately, now this had to come from a non-Muslim. Anyway, that's another story. But even Madulung, Professor Madulung in this book, has taken for granted the propaganda which exists in the earlier sources about Imam Hassan alayhi salam vis-a-vis the situation of Osman. For example, in one place he says, Hassan was fond of Osman and is later critical of his father for failing to defend Osman. Not only that, he goes on to quote a statement by earlier historians that one day Imam Amir al-Mu'mineen was passing by his son and he says to him, you know, do your wuzu fully. Don't do the short form. Now, first of all, we have a problem with that possibility itself. And in response, we are told that Hassan turns to his father and he says, you have killed a man who used to perform the ablution fully for every prayer, referring to Osman. When you look at that, you start thinking, what's going on? We believe in Ali as the first Imam, in Hassan as the second Imam. And in the issue of Osman, we're seeing, you know, there is a conflict between the father and the son, between the first and the second Imam. And from our point of view, from the theological point of view, this is not possible. ذُرِّيَّةٌ بَعْضُهَا مِنْ بَعْضٍ. They are all from the same source. They have been chosen by the same Almighty God. There could be no conflict within themselves when it comes to such issues. Salawat Pradhan Ekbar. Let me just give you 3-4 examples about this issue. And so we see that, you know, we have to be careful when we study history. Do not just take things for granted. First of all, how do you reconcile? Let me just say one more statement here, that by looking at this event, actually, this whole conversation about doing full wuzu, it's not Imam Hassan. There are some narrations in history where a person by the name of Hassan al-Basri, a Sunni theologian, was the one who was doing that, and Amir al-Mu'mineen told him, do your wuzu fully. And that's where Hassan al-Basri responds to Imam by saying, you are the one who killed a person who used to do full wuzu. His name was Hassan al-Basri. They omitted Basri there, linked that with Hassan bin Ali, and now they are saying, look, the son and the father had different views when it came to Osman ibn Affan. One example. You know, how can we say that Imam Hassan was against his father when we see that even when the Muslims of Medina, Kufa, Basra, and Egypt, delegations had come into Medina from Egypt, Kufa, and Basra, and joined with the companions of the Prophet of Medina, they were protesting against the unjust policies of Osman. Because he was very, nepotism was there. The Muslims were not getting their share of Baytul Mal. And many things happened. Eventually, these Muslims decided to force Osman to leave the Khilafah. And when he refused, they basically put his house under siege. They even stopped food and water reaching the house of Osman. Those days there was no pipeline which can come. You know, they had to bring water from the water well of the neighborhood. And at that time, it was Imam Ali alayhi salam. When he heard that even food and water is being prevented from the house of Osman, he is the one. He sends his own sons, Hassan and Hussein, with others, with food and water, to be taken to the house of Osman. Not because Ali agreed with the unjust policies of Osman. No, he was very much critical of him. But he didn't believe that this is the way of solving the problem. This is not the way to deal with this problem of Osman. And therefore, you know, he decided to fulfill his Islamic and humanitarian duty. And he sends his own sons, who are also the grandsons of the Prophet, with the hope that the people who had put the house of Osman under siege would not prevent the grandsons of the Prophet from breaking that siege. And so here we see that Hassan and Hussein are with Ali. They are doing whatever is being instructed by Amirul Mu'mineen. Number two, Hassan was with his father. In all events before the murder of Osman and even after the murder of Osman. How could Hassan side with Osman, whose policies were unjust, where he was using Banu Umayyah to basically, you know, oppress the Ummah? And that is why you had this complaint from people from Egypt, people from Kufa, Basra, all gathering, coming together in Medina. Salawat par nek par aur. We request the brothers to move to this side. There is empty space here. One more event, and this is before the murder of Osman, where you see there is absolutely no conflict between Hassan and Ali when it comes to the policies of Osman. And this is in the case of the famous companion Abu Zar al-Ghifari. Abu Zar al-Ghifari is a companion where the Prophet used to say that if there is anyone among my followers, among the companions, who is the most truthful person to walk on this earth, that's Abu Zar. And probably these words given by the Prophet for Abu Zar had a meaning, that a time will come where he will be speaking things. And when he saw, when Abu Zar realized the unjust policies of Osman, you know, he was first sent to Syria. They wanted Muawiyah to deal with him. But even there, he could not silence him. And he said to he used to say publicly that what you are doing here is not right. Islam didn't come to promote, you know, royalty, the way you behave with people. You know, Baytul Mal is not your personal property. It belongs to the Muslim people. And so Muawiyah basically sent a complaint to Osman. He says, you know, if you leave him here, you know, my control on the Syrian province will go. So Osman says, send him back to Medina. So he was sent back to Medina. In Medina also, Abu Zar continued to protest against the unjust policies of Osman. Eventually, Osman decided to send him to exile in a place called Rabza. When he was being sent outside Medina in exile, an announcement was done by the Khalifa, announced by his son-in-law, Marwan bin Hakam, who was also his chief of the staff, making all the decisions, that nobody is allowed to go and bid farewell to Abu Dhar when he's leaving Medina. Let him go alone. Amir al-Mu'mineen, when he heard about it, he decided to defy this command of the Khalifa in protest, that this is not fair, this is not right. And so he decided to go out to say Khuda Hafiz to Abu Zar, not alone. He took his sons, he took his nephews, he took his cousins, and a few other companions with him. Marwan bin Hakam came in the way to stop them. And Ali, you know, basically told him, go away. He insisted until Ali had to basically hit on his horse to move so that he can have way to move forward. And he says, you cannot stop me from going and meeting Abu Zar while he's leaving the city of Medina. After talking to Abu Zar and doing Khuda Hafizi, then Ali says to his sons, he says, now it's your turn to bid farewell to your uncle. Abu Zar was in age, he was like the uncle for the sons of Ali. And the conversation that Imam Hassan has, just very brief, where he says, Ya Amma, O uncle, if it had not been for the custom that the one who bids farewell should be silent, because he's eventually going to go back home, I would have talked quite a lot. Normally when you do Khuda Hafizi, you don't go into long, discussion. People are now living. But the words in such situation have to be brief. Even though the pain of parting will remain with me for a long time. So he feels, in grief, in pain for what is happening to Abu Zar and he's leaving them. Then he says, you see what has come upon you from these people, referring to Osman and his people. So remember the passing nature of this world and its difficulty. Remember that this dunya wouldn't last forever in hope of what is to come in the future. And have patience until you meet your prophet in a state that you are he is pleased with you. When you look at this statement, it is very clear that Hassan is absolutely with his father when it comes to protesting against the policies of Usman bin Affan. Salawat pardon. And these are the quotations from the common Muslim history. I'm not using Shia sources here. The third example, in the Battle of Jamal. This was a battle which took place in Basra, instigated by Talha and Zubayr, where they incorporated with themselves Aisha to misuse her status for their own, agenda. And they gathered in Basra, they occupied the city of Basra, and their slogan was that we are fighting against Ali because Ali is responsible for the murder of Osman. Or to put it in a more milder terms, they used to say, he is protecting the murderers of Osman. He should either hand them over so that we may deal with them, or we will deal with him. And in that situation, so it's interesting that you have a group using the murder of Osman as a pretext to fight against Ali. Look at the role of Imam Hassan there. Ali decided to deal with this group of the rebels. And when he found out that they are going towards Basra, when he reached to a place before Kufa, he was told that they have already occupied Basra and thrown out the governor of Ali from that city. Imam decided to get more reinforcement for his forces before he proceeds further. So he decides to send some people to Kufa to get some more people. First he sent Muhammad bin Abi Bakr, his own stepson, with Muhammad bin Jafar, another nephew of his, with a letter to the governor of Kufa by the name of Abu Musa al-Ash'ari, who was a hypocrite actually. They went there, talked with the governor, and the government. The governor says, I'm not sure about this conflict. I would rather be, neutral in this conflict, and I will not help you in gathering forces to go and support Ali. So they came back without any success. Then Amir al-Mu'mineen sent another person by the name of Hashim al-Mirqal. He also went, came back unsuccessful. Finally, Ali decides to send Hassan, his own son, along with Ammar al-Yasir. Ammar bin Yasir, and with a letter to Abu Musa al-Ash'ari, dismissing him from the position of governorship of Kufa, replacing him with another person. And so Imam Hassan goes there. He met the people in Masjid al-Kufa, and he gave a speech. The earlier part of it, there are actually two, three versions of it, and I'm using the common version, where he says to the people of Kufa, Ayuhannas, I'll leave the Arabic aside. O people, you know about the movement of Amir al-Mu'minin Ali ibn Abi Talib and the leaders of the Arabs who have already reached in your area. You also know about the pledge of allegiance of Talha and Zubair to my father and their rebellion thereafter, along with Aisha. By Allah, if none of you help him, then I hope that the Muhajirin and Ansar who are already with him would be sufficient for his purpose. But I urge you to help the cause of Allah. Go and join Ali. If you help the cause of Allah, Allah will indeed help you. At that moment, Abu Musa Ash'ari, the governor, who is now dismissed from that position, again stood up to discourage the people from getting involved in supporting Ali in this matter. And that is where Imam Hassan turns to Abu Musa Ash'ari and says, اعتزل عملنا أيها الرجل. That, O man, get away. You are no more part of our government, and keep your distance from our member. May your mother sit in your grief. It's a baddua. May you die and your mother grieve for you. And so he silenced him, and then he continued his speech where he says, O people, respond to the call of your leader and go towards your brethren. Verily, there are some who are hesitant to go forth in this manner. By Allah, if worthy ones take charge, it would be better for the present as well as the future, and good in the end. So respond to our call. Help us in this tribulation that we and you face together. And then he quotes his father. He says, Amir al-Mu'minin has indeed said, I have taken a stand. And in this stand against this group, either I am unjust or I am oppressed. Either I am zalim or mazlum. I ask you in the name of Allah, if I am mazlum, then come and help me. And if I am zalim, then come and fight against me. Don't sit there. Take action, get involved. And then he says, my father says, by Allah, Talha and Zubair were the first one to pledge allegiance to me, and they were the first one to betray me. Why did they do this? Have I taken anything from the Baytul Mal of the Muslimin? Have I changed a law in the Sharia? And so come forth and do Amra bil Ma'ruf and Nahi al Munkar. Don't be indifferent, get involved and support me in this matter. Salawat upon Nabi Akbar. He goes on to then describe the character of Ali to an extent that Hassan was able to move about 7,000 to 10,000 people in Kufa to join him, to join the army of Ali ibn Abi Talib alayhi salatu wa salam. Salawat upon Nabi Akbar. So Imam Hassan is getting 7,000 to 10,000 people from Kufa to join the army of his father to fight against these rebels in Jamal. And the historians would like to say that there was a conflict between the son and the father on the matter of, you know, Osman and what happened after that. Amir al-Mu'minin indeed was very pleased with the success of his own son. One more example. Then they went on to Basra to confront the army known as, you know, the group known as the group of Jamal. Jamal is the camel on which Aisha was riding. Before the battle, Amir al-Mu'minin gave them many, many opportunities to resolve the conflict without fighting. He even sent a person with the Quran to them, but they actually shot that person with the arrow and killed him. He sent messengers to Zubair and Talha. You know, Zubair, of course, when Ali reminded him of the words of Rasulullah. Remember, Zubair also is a cousin of Rasulullah. And Ali told him, Zubair, you forgot One day the Prophet told you that you are going to fight against me while you will be wrong. And he started shivering because he realized that he was on the wrong. Eventually, you know, things didn't work out. They decided to fight. But between that time, while still discussions were going on, Abdullah bin Zubair, the son of Zubair, gave a speech to the people of Basra in which he wanted to incite the people against Ali. And that report reached to Ali, in which he was saying that Inna Ali bin Abi Talib qatala al-Khalifa bil-Haq Usman. Now they are blaming Ali directly. They are saying Ali is the one who killed Usman. And now he has come with an army to occupy your city. He will kill your women, your children, take over your wealth. You know, therefore, and he will not consult any one of you in the matters of government. He wants to do whatever he thinks is right. And therefore, if he, you know, captures your city, you will be losers in this dunya as well as in the akhirah. MashaAllah, they knew everything about Islam. This is Abdullah bin Zubair. When Imam Ali heard about it, you see, they have to maintain protocol. This speech has been made not by Zubair, who would be equal to Ali in age at least. They are cousins. But this is now Abdullah bin Zubair. So Amir al-Mu'minin didn't feel appropriate to respond to somebody who is younger in relationship. And so he asked whom? He asked his son, in whom he had total confidence. He asked his son Hassan to stand up and respond to the speech of Abdullah bin Zubair. Imam Hassan stood up. And then he takes each statement, one by one, from Abdullah bin Zubair, and he says, and again I'm leaving Arabic aside, the statement of Ibn Zubair about my father has reached us, in which he says that my father killed Usman. O Muhajirin and Ansar and Muslims, you know the views of Zubair about Usman. Talha and Zubair were against Usman from day one. They were the first one to do bay'at to Ali after they instigated the rebellion against Usman. So he's saying, everyone knows, you know the views of Zubair about Usman and the nickname that he used for Usman and how he used to accuse Usman of wrongdoings. As for Talha, verily while Usman was still alive, Talha had planted his flag on the Baytul Mal, the treasury of the Muslims. So how can they accuse my father of killing him and hold him responsible for it? And then he says, if we wanted to say more about them, we can say quite a lot. Means Hassan is restraining himself here. He says, we know quite a lot about these people. Then he says, his statement that Ali has forcefully taken the government from the people, if this claim is true, that my father has done this by force, then the fault goes on his father, Zubair. He's now addressing Abdullah bin Zubair. Because his father, Zubair, is the first one who pledged allegiance in the hands of my father. So if my father is wrong, Zubair is the prime responsible person for that. But we know that he did bay'at and pledge allegiance to my father, only physically, but his heart was not with my father. As for his surprise that the people, Abdullah bin Zubair in his speech also wanted to incite the people of Basra by saying, see, people of Kufa have come also, joined Ali to fight against you. He's trying to create this tension between people of Kufa and the people of Basra. So Imam Hassan says, as for his surprise that the people of Kufa have risen against the people of Basra, he should not be surprised that the people of truth have stood up against the people of falsehood. As for the supporters of Osman, we don't want to fight them or kill them. لَكِنَّ نُحَارِبُ رَاكِبَةِ الْجَمَلْ وَأَطْبَاعِهَا. We are fighting against the rider of the camel and her followers. We are fighting those who are rebels against the rightful Khalifa of the time. Salawat upon Ekbar. Ali was so much proud of his own son. Last statement in English before I go to the Urdu part of the Majlis. When Imam reached to Kufa, he had some people, you know, using some derogatory remarks about Imam Hassan. They said, well, the father is a very eloquent speaker, but the son doesn't know to speak, doesn't know how to speak. And when these words reached to the ears of Amir al-Mu'mineen, didn't feel good about it. He gathered the people in the masjid, and he asked Imam Hassan that, why don't you go on the minbar and give a speech on whatever topic you want? He gave a short speech, but it's relevant to the ayat that I began with in this majlis. إِنَّ اللَّهَ اصْطَفَى آدَمَ وَنُوحًا وَآلَ إِبْرَاهِيمَ وَآلَ إِمْرَانَ عَلَى الْعَالَمِينَ ذُرِّيَّةٌ بَعْضُهَا مِنْ بَعْضٍ وَاللَّهُ سَمِيعٌ عَلِيمٌ. He says, أَيُّهَا النَّاسُ أَعْقَلُ مِنْ رَبِّكُمْ. All people, learn from your Lord. And then he recites the ayat, إِنَّ اللَّهَ عَزَّ وَجَلَّ اصطفى آدم ونوحا وآل إبراهيم وآل عمران على العالمين ذرية بعضها من بعض والله السميع العليم. And then he explains this ayat that I begin the speech with. That the ayat says, verily Allah has chosen Adam and Nuh and the family of Ibrahim and the family of Imran over the people. They are descendants one from the other, and Allah is all hearing and all knowing. Then Imam Hassan says, فَنَحْنُ وَالذُّرِّيَّةِ مِنْ آدَمٍ. We are the descendants of Adam. We are the family of Nuh. We are the chosen ones of Ibrahim. We are the children of Ismail. And we are the progeny of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. نَحْنُ فِيكُمْ كَالسَّمَاءِ الْمَرْفُوعَةِ والأرض المدحوة والشمس الزاحية. We, the Ahlul Bayt, among you, are like the raised sky, like the spread out earth and the shining sun. وكالشجرة الزيتونة لا شرقية ولا غربية التي بورك زيتها. And we are like the olive tree, referring to this ayat from Surah An-Nur, Ash-Shajaratul Mubarakah, where Allah talks about the blessed tree. Imam is referring to that. We are like the olive tree, which is neither inclined to the east or the west, whose oil is blessed. And then he says that An-Nabi Asluha, when you look at that blessed tree, the Prophet is the root of that tree. Ali is the branch of that tree. And we, by Allah, are the fruits of that tree. So whoever holds on to any of the branches of this tree, he is successful. And he will be successful in the hereafter. And whoever keeps away from it, he indeed is going to fall into the fire of Jahannam. Salawat upon Ekbar. Ali was indeed proud of his son. Imam Hassan got down from the minbar. Ali goes in the minbar and says, Yabna Rasulillah. The father is now honoring his own son. Doesn't say, Ya Bunayya. He says, Yabna Rasulillah, O son of the Prophet. You know, respecting his relationship as the grandson of the Prophet. You proved your argument against the people, and you made their obedience to you obligatory by reciting this ayat and presenting yourself as a chosen one according to the ayat from Surah Al-Imran. They have the obligation to obey you. فَوَيْلٌ لِمَنْ خَالَفَكَ So woe be to the one who opposes you. Salawat padne ek par. So when you read history, the whole point of my talk is that be careful. Sometimes we get overwhelmed because we have been hearing one thing and then all of a sudden you see something different. And then you realize these are some of the early sources of Muslim history. Keep in mind there's biases in there, half-truths are there, omissions are there, and total fabrications are also there quite a lot. And this has come in even in the modern literature about Muslim history. There was absolutely no difference between Imam Hassan and Ali in any matter. Both of them are ma'soom. Both of them are imam. And an imam cannot be against another imam in any way or shape or form. Salawat upon Ek Bala. कोशिश हिस्ट्री में बहुत हुई है कि हसन को अली से जुदा किया जाए. ये भी जुल्म है. और अजीब लोग हैं, कभी कभी रसूल की हदीस को यूज करते हैं. रसूल की एक हदीस है कि जहां ये कहा जा गया है और उसका एक मीनिंग है, वो सही भी है इन इट्स ऑन कॉन्टेक्स्ट. جہاں رسول کا کہنا ہے کہ حسن ہماری طرح ہے اور حسین علی کی طرح ہے. ہمارے بھائی لوگ کیا کہتے ہیں, رسول اللہ پیس فل تھے لہذا حسن نے پیس کی, صلح کی, اور علی جو ہیں غصے والے تھے لہذا حسین نے جنگ لڑی. اس طرح سے ڈیوائڈ کرتے ہیں. اور کبھی کبھی اس ٹائم حدیث کو یوز کرتے ہیں کہ بھائی حسن اور علی میں جو ہے ٹیمپرمنٹ کے لحاظ سے, ذوق کے اعتبار سے, تدبیر کے اعتبار سے اختلاف رہا ہے. وہ بھی عثمان کے معاملے کہ حسن جو ہیں عثمان کی طرف ہوں, یہ کس طرح سے ہو سکتا ہے؟ وہ علی جنہوں نے بہت ہی سخت الفاظ یوز کیے ہیں عثمان کے لیے, ان کی پالیسیز کی تنقید میں اور کرٹیسزم میں, اس میں حسن جو ہیں عثمان کا ساتھ دیں گے؟ اور بہت کوشش کی ہے دشمن نے. صفین میں ایک واقعہ آپ کے سامنے پیش کر لیں اور پھر مجلس کو ختم کرنا چاہیں گے. معاویہ نے عبیداللہ بن عمر کا ایک اور بیٹا تھا عبداللہ کے علاوہ, اس کو بھیجا جنگ وغیرہ سے پہلے فتنہ کے لیے کہ جاؤ حسن کو پروپوز کرو, دیٹ اف ہی سیپریٹس فرام ہز فادر وی ول میک ہم دی خلیفہ. یعنی یہ نیت کی خرابی کی ایک حد ہوتی ہے. پلاننگ دیکھیں تو عبیداللہ بن عمر جو ہیں وہ جاتے ہیں امام حسن کے پاس کہ لی الی کا حاجت, کہ آپ سے ذرا کام ہے. تو امام حسن نے کہا کہ کیا چاہیے تمہیں؟ تو کہتا ہے کہ ان اباک قد وطر قریشا اولا واخرا وقد شنوه, کہ آپ کے بابا نے جو ہیں قریش کے جو لیڈرز تھے شروع سے آخر تک سب کی جو ہے صفائی کر دیے, اور لہٰذا ان سے دشمنی ہے, ان کے دل میں دشمنی ہے علی کے سلسلے میں. تو کیا آپ تیار ہیں کہ آپ اپنے بابا کی مخالفت کریں؟ ونولی کہاد الامر, اپنے فادر کے اگینسٹ ہو جائیں تو یہ خلافت کو ہم آپ کے حوالے کر دیں گے. یعنی ہمت دیکھیں. حسن نے بڑے غصے میں کہا کل واللہ لا یکون ذلک, خدا کی قسم یہ کس طرح کبھی بھی نہیں ہو سکتا, ممکن ہی نہیں ہے. اور پھر امام نے کہا کہ جہاں تک تمہاری بات ہے عبداللہ عبیداللہ بن عمر, اب یہ علم غیب والی بات ہے. امام اس سے کہتے ہیں عبیداللہ بن عمر, ہم دیکھ رہے ہیں اس دن کو کہ اسی میدان میں تمہیں قتل کر دیا جائے گا, تم مقتول ہوگے. شیطان نے تمہارے عمل کو نیک بنا کے تیرے سامنے پیش کیا ہے اور تو شیطان کے بہکاوے میں آ چکے ہو. عبیداللہ بن عمر نے حسن کے لہجے کو دیکھ کے ڈر گیا اور وہاں سے نکلا. Especially Imam Hassan ne jo kaha tha ki hum dekh rahe hain wo manzar ke tum jo hai yahi is jang mein qatl kiye jaoge. Ghabra gaya. Jata hai Muawiya ke paas aur kaha ki bhai hamari jo scheme thi wo kamyab nahi hui. Us waqt Imam Hassan ke is jumle ko sunne ke baad Muawiya ne ek tafsira kiya hai. اور جملہ وہ معاویہ کا ہمارے اس تمام ڈسکشن کا خلاصہ ہے. ہسٹری نے کوشش کی ہے کہ حسن اور علی کو ایک دوسرے سے الگ کرے. امام حسن کے اس جواب کو سننے کے بعد معاویہ کیا کہتا ہے عبیداللہ بن عمر سے, انہو ابن عبیہی, یقینا حسن اپنے بابا کی اولاد ہے. یہ علی کا بیٹا ہے, یہ جو بات کر رہے ہیں یہ علی کے بیٹے ہیں, ان دونوں میں ہم جدائی کبھی بھی نہیں ڈال سکتے ہیں. صلوات پڑھنے ایک بار اور. معاویہ نے بہت کوشش کی امام حسن امام علی کی شہادت کے بعد. وہ جانتا تھا کہ اگر امام حسن سے جنگ ہو اور امام حسن کو شکست دیں گے تو حکومت تو مل جائے گی لیکن حکومت میں ہمیں جواز نہیں ملے گا, شریع اعتبار سے جسٹیفائیڈ نہیں ہوگا چونکہ ہم نے جنگ کے ذریعے حکومت حاصل کی ہے. لہذا اس نے یہ پیس ٹریٹی کے لیے پروپوز کیا تھا. لیکن امام نے بھی اس ٹائپ کی کنڈیشنز ڈال دی کہ معاویہ کا خواب جو ہے کبھی بھی زندہ نہیں ہو سکتا, اس کو کبھی بھی وہ شریع جواز نہیں ملا. اس کا خواب یہ تھا کہ اس خلافت کو ملوکیت میں بدل دے, وہ ملوکیت جو شرعی بنیاد پر ہو, ڈائنیسٹی ہو جو جسٹیفائیڈ ہو شرعی بنیاد پر. لیکن امام حسن نے ایک شرط لگا دی تھی کہ تمہیں کوئی حق نہیں ہے کہ اپنے بعد کسی کو اپنا سکسیسر اور جانشین مقرر کرو, اور اس نے سائن کیا تھا اس پہ. اور اس لیے امام حسن نے حکومت چھوڑ دی, لیکن حسن کا وجود معاویہ کے لیے ایک مشکل تھا, ایک مصیبت بن گئی تھی. وہ اپنے عزائم اور اپنے خواب کو کبھی بھی تعبیر کے اس لیول پر نہیں لا سکتا تھا کہ جب تک امام حسن زندہ رہے. لہذا مشکل مختلف طریقے سے کوشش کی اور آخر میں اس کو وہ حربہ ملا کہ جودہ بنت اشعس, اس کا خاندان بہرحال علی کا دشمن تھا پہلے سے, اور اسی کے ذریعے ایکسس ملا, اور معاویہ نے اس کو لالچ دی دولت کی بھی اور یہ کہ یزید کے ساتھ شادی ہو جائے گی تو بعد میں جو بادشاہ ہوگا تم راج کرو گی. اس لالچ میں آ کے وہ ملعونہ جو ہے تیار ہو جاتی ہے کہ وہ امام حسن کو زہر دے. گرمی کا زمانہ تھا, امام مستحبی روزہ رکھے ہوئے تھے. گرمی کے زمانے میں انسان جب روزہ رکھتا ہے اور جب افطار کا وقت آتا ہے یقیناً پیاس لگی ہوئی ہوتی ہے. جودہ بنت اشعث جو ہے دودھ کا پیالہ لے آتی ہے. امام حسن علیہ السلام نے اپنا افطار کیا, اس کو دودھ کو جب پی لیتے ہیں تب فوراً احساس ہوا کہ اس میں زہر ملا ہوا. امام پیالے کو واپس کرتے ہیں اور کہتے ہیں جودہ تمہارا جو مقصد تھا اس میں تم کامیاب ہو گئی. طبیعت خراب ہوتی ہے, کئی لوگ آئے کئی دن تک طبیعت خراب رہی. جب معلوم ہوا کہ زہر دیا گیا ہے کئی لوگوں نے کہا کہ آپ علاج کریں, طبیب کو بلائیں. امام نے کہا کہ یہ پہلی بار نہیں ہوا ہے, تین بار اور کوشش ہو چکی ہے مجھے زہر دینے کے لیے لیکن یہ کامیاب نہیں رہے. لیکن اب کی جو ہے وہ زہر ملایا گیا ہے کہ جس کا کوئی مداوا اور علاج نہیں ہے. ایک وقت بھی آتا ہے انسان جب بیمار پڑتا ہے, خصوصاً جب مظلومیت کی حالت میں, تو گھر والے آتے ہیں عیادت کے لیے, تیمارداری کے لیے, احوال پرسی کے لیے. اور یقیناً اگر بھائی کا کوئی بہن ہو, جناب زینب بھی آتی تھی اور بھائی کی اس کیفیت کو دیکھ کے روتی تھی. خصوصاً وہ وقت بھی آیا کہ جب امام نے قے کرنا شروع کیا تشت کو لایا گیا تو دیکھا گیا کہ زہر کے اثر سے جگر کے ٹکڑے جو ہے قے میں گر کے تشت میں گر رہے ہیں. زینب نے رونا شروع کیا, وا محمد وا علی اور وا فاطمہ کی آواز بلند ہوئی. وہ دن بھی آیا کہ امام جس دن وفات پائی ہے, امام کہتے ہیں امام حسین سے کہ میرے بستر کو صحن میں لایا جائے, ہم چاہتے ہیں کہ میرا آخری وقت کھلے آسمان میں گزرے. آسمان کی طرف نظر رہی, آخری وصیتیں شروع کرتے ہیں عزادار اور حسین. امام حسن امام حسین اصرار کرتے رہے کہ بھائی یہ بتائیے کس نے زہر دیا ہے. امام حسن نے کہا کہ نہیں یہ معاملہ میرا ہے, آخرت میں یہ خدا فیصلہ کرے گا. لیکن جو وصیتیں کی ہے اس میں ایک وصیت خاص تھی کہ بھائی میری تمنا ہے کہ نانا کے پہلو میں مجھے دفن کیا جائے. عزادارہ حسین یہ وہ نواسا ہے کہ جس کے بارے میں رسول کہتے تھے کہ اس کا خون میرا خون ہے, اس کا گوشت میرا گوشت ہے. جس سے وہ محبت کرے اس سے ہم محبت کرتے ہیں, جس سے وہ دشمنی کرے وہ میرا دشمن ہے. ان تمام باتوں کے باوجود جہاں تاریخ نے حسن کو علی سے جدا کرنے کی کوشش کی ہے, آخر میں وفات پر حسن کو نانا سے جدا کیا گیا. امام حسن نے لیکن وصیت کی تھی کہ اگر بھائی لوگوں نے دفن ہونے سے روکا ہے تو میری وصیت ہے تلوار نہ نکالنا, بلکہ جنت البقیع میں ماں کے پہلو میں دفن کر دینا. حسن کا جنازہ اٹھا, شوکت و شان کے ساتھ اٹھتا ہے, مسجد النبی کی طرف بڑھا تاکہ رسول کے جوار میں دفن کیا جائے. لیکن ایک مرتبہ عائشہ اور آل مروان والے آتے ہیں, اس حسن کو نواسے کو نانا سے مہینے ملنا چاہتے ہیں. عبداللہ بن عباس نے بہت کوشش کی, آخر میں آل مروان نے تیروں کی بارش کی جو تابوت پہ آ کے لگے ہیں. امام حسین نے بڑے غصے کے عالم میں کہا تھا, اے دشمنان اسلام میرے بھائی کی وصیت نے میرے ہاتھ کو باندھ دیا ہے, ورنہ ہم بتاتے کس طرح سے تلوار کے سہارے بھائی کو نانا کے جوار میں دفن کرتے. امام کو لا کے جنت البقیع میں سپرد خاک کیا گیا. امام حسن کو امام حسین کو آج پرسا دینے کے لیے ایک جملہ ہم کہیں گے, مولا آپ کی ہاں آپ کا ہاتھ آپ کے بھائی کی وصیت کی وجہ سے بند تھے, لیکن آپ کے بیٹے کے ہاتھ ہتھکڑی کی وجہ سے بند تھے. آپ نے بھائی کو دفن تو کر دیا, لیکن ہاں وہ سجاد جو دیکھتا رہا کربلا سے روانہ ہوا, لیکن بابا کا کف لاشا بیرو بے گور کفن زمین کربلا میں پڑا رہا. بات میں حسین